Good afternoon and welcome to our program celebrating Black History Month. I'm Jill Savitt, the CEO of the National Center for Civil and Human Rights. We have a real treat today. Our guest is George C. Wolfe, the director of the Netflix film Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. George is a five-time Tony Award winner and a master storyteller. He has brought to stage and screen the work of Zora Neale Hurston and Jelly Roll Morton, Savion Glover, and Elaine Stritch. He told the story of Henrietta Lacks. He directed the original Broadway production of Angels in America, Millennium Approaches, and its follow-up, Angels in America, Perestroika. As well as The Normal Heart and The Iceman Cometh, starring Denzel Washington, to name just a few of his masterworks over the course of his career. There's all that, including being named a living landmark by the New York Landmarks Conservancy, but he is someone extra special here in Atlanta. George was the chief creative officer for our center and the curator of our permanent civil rights exhibition, Rolls Down Like Water. George, welcome back to the center.
Great, thank you. Hello, how are you doing?
Good, thanks. So I hope our audience has all seen the film. If they haven't, they can catch it on Netflix. But can you give everyone a brief summary of this, of the story?
Well, the story is about Ma Rainey, who is called the mother of the blues, Gertrude Ma Rainey. And she has come to Chicago with her band in 1927 for a recording session. She's there meeting Irving, her manager, and then Sturdivant, who also runs the studio, who's white. She has, as part of her band, of a four-person band, there's a young trumpet player, cornet player named Levy, who views Chicago like many Black people at the time did because of the Great Migration as a place where all sorts of possibilities are going to happen and where he's going to stake his claim in the music field. He's going to record an album, he's going to record his songs. All of these great things are happening. He's young and he's ambitious. And Ma wants her band to be nice background and accompaniment band so they can feature her. And Levy is a blues musician, but he also has the impulse of, for lack of better words, a jazz musician in the sense that if he feels that he wants to play it. Also, he's young and he's got a large ego and he's very passionate about what he does. So he acts from impulse, not from strategy. And you see Ma fighting for control of her music, of her life, of every single thing that that matters to her. Levy is looking for a chance to fulfill his ambition. At the same time, through the course of the film, we realize that he is, as all the characters are in their own way, negotiating a relationship with painful things from their past. And then I'll say from an opening, from what I like to call a prologue, and at the end, it's all compressed in one day, in one hot, intense day in Chicago in 1927.
Yeah, that's great. I want to start with Ma Rainey, such an incredible figure. What drew you to want to tell her story?
Well, you know, one of the things that I love about the character as crafted by August Wilson, I should also add that it's based on his play, Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, and there were changes that were made when it was being transformed into a film. But as crafted by August, one of the things I love is that she is acutely aware of her work. She is acutely aware of her own sense of power, and she doesn't wait for anyone to give her power. She claims it, she owns it, she demands it. She is authoritative, she's a brilliant artist, and she makes people jump through hoops in order for her to clear the space so that she can protect her art, her story, her songs, which are connected to her community, which is the Southern Black community. And one of the things that I think is very interesting about Ma, and one of the things that Viola Davis and I talked about very early on, is that, you know, she was a protege and probably, though not officially determined, Bessie Smith were lovers. So Bessie has now started to usurp her in terms of records and popularity and visibility. One of the things that's really interesting, little side note, is that when I started editing the film, I found out that there are a total of 7 photographs in existence of Ma Rainey, period.
Whoa. Wow.
Which is points to how fragile one's career is, particularly at that time. Whereas Ms. Smith became this huge star, and there are tons of pictures of her everywhere because she ended up doing the New York circuit, and she was claimed by white, the white intellectual circles. And so she was written up in Vanity Fair. Ma Rainey never experienced this type of fame. But so there's an interesting dynamic to Ma because, and once again, that's crafted by August, is it's toward the end of her career. It's set in 1927. She never recorded again after 1928. So we're also watching a woman who is fighting against time, you know, in terms of her career, but mainly, I just love the fact that she decided her own success. She decided her own power. She shattered rules and broke boundaries and stood up for what she stood up and believed in what she believed in. And it also reminded me of the women in my family. So that sense of power, that sense of command felt really, it's sort of like her toughness felt very warm and reassuring to me in some odd way, because I grew up around that. I grew up around people, you know, my grandmother in particular was a force and protected that which she loved. And Ma protects that which she loves. She protects her band members, but also she protects her song. She protects her career. And so all of that just, I loved her. And I remember seeing, I went to the first fitting of Viola's costume with Ann Roth, the costume designer, and she put on the bodysuit for her. And then at one point she had a mock-up of the dress that we see her wear through most of the film. And Ann Roth gave her this little white cap. And at one point she was just sitting in the chair, and for one brief moment, you know, and it was all very technical, put your arm here, do this, we're pinning this, we're adjusting that. But just when she was sitting in the chair, she subtly altered her posture. And, you know, and there was no, I think there may have been a wig on, I don't think there really was, but there, it was not lights, camera, action. It was just a moment in a fluorescent room. And for just one brief moment, Viola just shifted her posture or her head. And then you saw Ma.
Yeah.
For a few seconds. And then it went away, and then we went back to discussing whatever was being discussed. But just seeing the flash of her finding herself inside of this woman who requires demand and accepts and expects respect from everybody around.
So that let's dig in on that, because at one point she confides to one of the musicians, they don't care nothing about me. All they want is my voice. And that you could tell that she understood all of the dynamics going on around her. And it for me, it seemed like that's the knowledge of that is one of the reasons she was absolute about the respect to be accorded to her. So we want to watch a scene where this is particularly relevant.
Okay.
Okay, Ma, we're ready to go.
Where's my Coke?
Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, boys.
Where's my Coke? I need a Coke. Hard as it is, sure. I need a Coke.
What's the matter, Ma?
Where's my Coke? I need a Coke, Coca-Cola.
Ma, look. I forgot the Coke. Let's do it without it, huh? Just this one song. What say, boys?
Damn what the band say. You're supposed to have my Coca-Cola. You knew that. I knew nothing without my Coca-Cola.
Just a minute here, Ma. You come in an hour later.
You need to get out of my face, Irvin. I told you to keep him away from me.
I'm tired of the nonsense, Irvin. I'm not going to put up with this.
Let me. Ma, listen. I'll call down to the deli and I'll get you a Coke, but let's get started, huh? Sylvester's standing there ready to go. The band's all set up. Let's do this one song.
I'm too cheap to buy me a Coca-Cola. I buy my own. Slow drag, Sylvester. Come on, baby. Get me 3 bottles of Coca-Cola, ice cold. Get y'all something, too. Keep the change.
Yes, ma'am.
Irvin, get away from me. Yeah, you can wait till I get my Coca-Cola. Ain't gonna kill you.
Okay, Ma.
I mean, just so powerful. So it's just a Coca-Cola on one level, but it's respect, it's authority, it's I can do it myself. If you're not gonna do it for me, I'll take care of it. Just a very powerful scene. Can you talk about this issue of respect. I mean, we're in Black History Month, and I think right now it's very timely, respect in Black women. And yeah. what Black women mean right now in our society. I'm here in Atlanta, Georgia, where one particular Black woman has helped change the face of our political life. You know, Stacey Abrams.
Yeah, well, also on a real fundamental, simple level, it is a hot, horrible day.
Okay.
There is no air conditioning, you know. There is none of it is going on. She's called upon to perform and deliver. And the circumstances are less than hospitable. You know what I mean? And she's expected to reach down from her gut and just use the power of her voice and the power of her culture and the power of everything that she is to display it, to put it out so they can capture it, so that therefore they can make money off of it. So she's demanding, you want that, you know my condition, this is how this is going to work. And it's one of the things that's really interesting about the Levy and Ma dynamic. Levy believes that all you need is talent and charm, and you can get what you want. And that's his naivete. And things don't end up so well for him, needless to say. And Ma is acutely aware of the power structure, of the white power structure. She's also acutely aware, interestingly enough, one of the things which I found really fascinating is that she has a line which she had with Irving, where she says, I don't like it up here anyway, i.e. the South. I can take my ass back down South where I belong. In the South, she has, you know, there's segregation, there's lynching, there's Jim Crow laws, there are all the statues celebrating, you know, dead traitors of the country, i.e. the Confederacy. And all of that's going on. But within that dynamic, she's been able to build, she's a showbiz entrepreneur. She owns two theaters in Georgia. She tours around. I got a list from the Ma Rainey House, you know, for her schedule for 1927. I think it was for 1927, 1926. And she's performing 30 or 40 different places all throughout the South. So she built her own empire. So when she's making demands, she's not just speaking as an angry person. She's speaking as a person who is acutely aware of her power, who is acutely aware of her success, who has made them a ton of money. And so she's coming forward going, this is what I require. You want me to record? This is what I require. So she's speaking from a place of not just this abstract notion of power, but a proven power and a proven success and a proven economic force. And then you have, you know, just tons of people throughout the civil rights movement who went, no, this is how this is going to work. Joan Robinson, boycotts, no, this is how this is going to work. That's not interesting to me. Your definition of me doesn't work for me. So I guess what we're going to have to do is dismantle the whole system. So if you want to adjust to how I see myself, if you want to allow people to vote the way they should vote, I guess we're going to have to go step by step, person by person, door by door, and alter the whole structure. Then maybe you'll get it.
Yeah.
Then maybe you will understand this is not going to work anymore. Your structure that you put forth into the world serves you. It doesn't serve me. So guess what's going to happen? We're going to take that structure apart. And we're going to reconfigure it so that it serves more people like me, so that it looks and feels and breathes more like what America is supposed to be, not your definition of America, but a broader definition of America. And my in her Coca-Cola is a version of that. It's you know, there's this moment in the movie where after she gets her three Coca-Cola, she's standing there, taking her time to drink it, and you know she could share it with some of the families. But no, there is the diva equation inside of the politics, inside of the self-worth, inside of the demand. There is a little bit diva monster going on, but she's allowed because she's brilliant. But in any case, it is like, if it's not serving me, then it's going to have to change.
Yeah, that glug 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 moment with the Coca-Cola is really, it comes off funny, you know. It's humor in the film. I wanted to go back to the very opening scene, which I think was so interesting. You get Ma with a bang in the tent performing. It talks about all the things that you've just said she had, all the power that she knew she had amassed in the South with her audience. And it's just a wow of an experience to watch her in that element.
Well, it was a wow of an experience to film it. It was very fascinating. We filmed in Pittsburgh, ironically enough, August Wilson's 10 play cycle, Ma Rainey's Black Bottom is the only one that's not set in Pittsburgh. It's set in Chicago. It's the only one where there's a famous character. It's the only character in the whole canon who's an LGBTQ person. So there are all these unique things, which is one of the things that I really love about it, because it's not, all the other plays, which are really wonderful and powerful, have a family dynamic. This is about people striking out on their own, and they discuss family in a very intimate way. But they're, in many respects, they're orphans. They're orphans finding their way in a very complicated world. But so we filmed it, but ironically enough, in Pittsburgh. And we filmed it Friday after the first scene we filmed was Ma confronting the policeman. And that was on a Monday. And that Friday we filmed the tent show. And it was one of the most fascinating things, because when Viola came on set and the music started to play, these extras were some of the most stunning extras I've ever worked with in my entire life. And I don't know if it was because Viola from How to Get Away with Murder or any of her other films, but when she walked onto the set, they started screaming. And it was a level of devotion that Ma Rainey's fans had for her, that they were showering on Viola as Ma Rainey. And it stunned us. And they were like this for the 4 or 5 or 6 hours that we filmed. I don't even remember. Every single take, they would go loud. Every single take, they were pouring their entire energy into the moment. There was a woman there who was 97 years old. And they showed up at, I think the extras were there like at 6, and we started filming sometime like around 8 or something like that. And we went at least until 2 o'clock in the morning. And at one point, I sent one of the first AD's team over to let her know, I have a close-up of her, she can go, but thank her very much. Because she was an older woman, and she went, I don't want to leave. This reminds me of what it was like when I was young. So it was that degree of devotion. And it was thrilling, because they brought an ideal thing, which is this connection between Ma and her audience. And this needless to say, this sequence isn't in the play. It's one of the things that I wanted to add, because in the structure of the play, we spend about 40 minutes of the band members waiting for Ma to show up, and they're telling great, wonderful stories. Some of, you know, probably about, I think, 30 to 40 minutes of material I had to cut. But I wanted to see Ma as soon as we possibly could, because it is called Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, and I wanted to see the icon. So the time, anytime anybody talks about her, we've been in the presence of the icon. We've seen the devotion. We start out with two young Black men running, and then we all know what that is, because we know the stories and we've seen the movies. So if you see two Black people running, you assume they're running from something. If you have dogs barking and you have the cicada, you see the cicadas in the tree, we know what all of that is. And so we're going forward into that dynamic, but we realize that they're not running from something, they're running to something. They're running to the affirmation that they feel when they are in the presence of her song and her voice.
Yeah.
And so it was very important for me to establish her power base. So that therefore, she's not, it's not just a person going off. I have power. I know my power. I know my worth. And that's why, and I wanted to come up with a visual manifestation of her going, I can take my ass back down south where I belong. And she's not just talking about going back down south, you know, and eating collard greens. She's going back down south where she has an empire.
Yeah, it's a really powerful, it's powerful, just a knockout to start. And yes, those two boys running, my first response was, uh-oh.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, there was sort of disequilibrium on a bunch of levels in watching that opening that really does set it up.
Oh, great. Thank you.
I want to talk about this movie coming out at this moment. Mm-hmm. So we're in a moment of reckoning about race, about history, about our past. And this film is really touches on so many issues in civil rights history, lynchings, cultural appropriation, white supremacy. What do you think it means for this film to appear right now?
Well, it's very interesting. When you work on any project, you go into a bubble. You just go into this bubble and you lose contact with the rest of the world because you're working, 12, 14, 16 hours a day. And so we filmed this August 2019. And then starting in late September, I started editing it. And then as we continued to edit, I was going, this is reverberating. And then, I was 3 weeks shy of finishing outpost production on it when the shutdown happened. And then following the shutdown, I continued to do work on like the visual effects and doing sound mix, very cautiously because of the shutdown, but continuing to do the work. And then all the protests were happening. And then I was just like going, can we put this out now? Let's hurry up and finish this a week to put it out now. I want it out now. I want it to be in conversation with this moment. I wanted to be in conversation with this moment. And Netflix had already said when they wanted to release it. And I was going, no, it has to happen now, And then, needless to say, it didn't happen. It was released sometime, it was released in starting in November and then later December 18th. I was just, when you do work, you feel so isolated from the world, and then you're making something that feels like it has a responsibility to the world that you feel isolated from. So I just wanted that to happen. But I think that, this being America, the conversation is ongoing. The conversation about white supremacy and about violations and about, brutality and injustice and owning one's power and standing in defiance of corrupt thought process and corrupt systems. It's an ongoing conversation, unfortunately. And so it was very fascinating and startling, particularly when dealing with the character of Levy, because he is a charming, charismatic, brilliant knucklehead, because he's young. He is the future. He understands the new sound. One of the tragedies to me is that if he and Ma could connect, he could learn some of her understanding of strategy and power and surviving racial power structures in this country. And she would get a sense of the new music sound that is emerging, but they don't connect. And so as a result of that, Levy is this creature, this person of extraordinary power and possibility. He's also haunted and deeply, deeply damaged by the scars of something that he experienced when he was a very young boy. And at an age where he did not have, as if any age, we have the emotional equipment to survive the degree of brutality that he witnessed. So to me, he is America. He is the promise of the possibility and then the scars of the past. And will we ever have enough moments of reckoning so an authentic healing can take place so that therefore the promise of the future can begin to fully manifest itself? And there are times where we feels like we're leaping forward and moving forward. And then instantaneously, we find ourselves moving backwards, just with at an accelerated pace. That's what we just experienced for the past 4 years. And so now we're trying to see if we can move forward. And perpetually, people, you know, are investing in the possibility of change, but that change is happening in the face of people who are terrified of the end of it all. They believe that one's freedom and one's right to be free means that they will lose freedom, that they will lose privilege. And yes, they will lose privilege, but they become part of something that's larger. And it's really fascinating to me, because by going back into the past, you're confronting pain, but you're also confronting stories of survival, of continuum, stories of connection, and people's terror and horror about going back in the past keeps on short-circuiting the possibility.
Yeah.
Short-circuiting the possibility. There are moments of coalition. There are moments of defiance. There are moments of joy. There are moments of breakthrough that will give us the power to transform this country the way that it needs to be transformed. But people are terrified of it, and that terror and that rigidity and that sense of this is mine and I'm not sharing it leads to destruction and despair and a degree of suffocation that will destroy this country.
Absolutely. I mean, it would seem August Wilson was pessimistic if you look at the character of Levy and what happened to him. Do you think he was pessimistic about the answer to that, to what will happen?
I don't think so, because you have a character who is trapped by the pain, and then you have a character who is using the force of who she is and where she comes from to shatter opposition. And they're sharing, and then you have other characters as well, you know, who are also sharing their stories of survival. And so any time there are stories of survival, hopefully we can find our own sense of survival, our own sense of work, our own sense of belief and faith inside of those stories. And we can also recognize Levy's possibilities and his shortcomings and his pain. And I think in some respects, in order to heal, you have to confront the pain. And some people, and Levy confronts the pain, but because it happened to him when he was such a young boy, it's a monumental thing to overcome. It's so monumental. So I think what August is offering us is a recipe for how one can heal and how one cannot heal.
Yeah, and face the truth.
100%, absolutely.
What it requires to face it.
Exactly. And owning it and claiming it and fighting through the pain to come out on the other side. And there's Toledo, and there are the other characters who are offering Levy an alternative way of thinking, but because he was robbed of both of his parents at such a young age, he's had to heal himself, and that's an impossibility. So on top of this 32-year-old, charismatic, powerful, commanding human being is a deeply wounded, deeply scarred 9-year-old boy. And in some respects, that's America. There is a small, frightened, damaged human being terrified of the future.
Yeah.
Because they're being scarred by the past.
I mean, the generational dynamic is big in this film.
Absolutely.
Of what elders are imparting to youngers, of what youngers want. I mean, very much as in the exhibition you curated, generations plays a huge role in the struggle of one way to do things and people just chomping to do things in a new way. How did you see the role of generations in this?
Well, it's very interesting. Levy sort of raised himself. Levy was born into a Black community that was nurturing and empowering. His father owned all this land. So he's part of a community of accomplishment. He's part of a community of accomplishment and felt this incredible sense of support. And then that was taken away from him. And so he's left without an anchor. He's left without an emotional anchor. And so he's just reckless. And he's just reckless and young and striking out. And in some respects, he's like this sort of warped version of the talented tenor that W.B. Du Bois is talking about, this belief that talent is enough. This belief that if I'm smart and if I'm talented, it will shatter resistance to me and my culture and who I am. And he doesn't anyway have the intellectual heft of people who believe in the talented concept, but he's still acting in some strange way from that thought process. And he needs knowledge. He needs the knowledge of that which has come before him. He just needs it. We all need it so that therefore we can then pick and choose. That works for me, that doesn't work for me. That works for me, that doesn't work for me. Martin Luther King marched through Frankfort, Kentucky, my hometown. God knows why he came to Frankfort, Kentucky. And he marched, and my grandmother took me out of school and I held her hand when I was 8 and I marched with her. How much information was passed on to me while holding her hand while she was marching? And so you need the stories. You need those stories. You need the truth. And I remember at one point when I was working on my first Broadway show, I was working with this extraordinary man called Luther Henderson, who was doing the music. And then at one point, I was talking about the producers or something that was going on. I said, well, I don't need that, and I don't need this, and I don't, and I was going, blah, blah, blah. You know, I'm young, I'm brazen, it's my first Broadway show, I'm doing all this hard work, and it's, you know, and this, and I'm ready to strike out. And he went, no. If you are not aware how people perceive you, they will use your lack of understanding against you. And I shut up. who talks a lot, who thinks that I know so much, I shut the hell up because there was something in his voice that resonated with knowledge and truth and history.
Yeah.
And it was. I remember that moment vividly because I was in the presence of something that was. I was in the presence of something and someone who had just been on the planet longer than me, who had gone to Juilliard when he was a young person, whose mother was a part of the Harlem Renaissance, who had been in a number of rooms, who had been in a number of situations, and who had confronted a number of things. And so in that moment, my sense of arrogance was replaced by being receptive and receiving that information. I then would end up doing a lot of stuff my way, but I can hearken back to crucial moments of my life where something was said to me and I listened and allowed that information to have an impact on me. And that's very, 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 I think it's very crucial as to how we come forward. And a lot of times those things which are said are circumstantial. They are based on the particulars of what happened to that generation at that point in time. And so that becomes anecdotal, but then there are truths. Then there are facts. And then when you're in the presence of those facts, hopefully you have the ability to turn off ego and arrogance and receive that which is being passed on because it's crucial to your survival.
Yeah, Levy refused to listen. He didn't put on any of the armor that Ma Rainey had put on. He didn't demand things, didn't demand the respect, and he got taken.
Yeah, because he believes he was enough.
Yeah.
He believes that he was enough. And the astonishing brutality of racism is, it's not personal. We receive it as personal, but it's just a blanket judgment. Anybody who looks like you doesn't matter.
Right.
You know, going back to Frankfort, Kentucky, I was like, you know, my town was segregated for the first 8 years of my life. And I recently went back and they celebrated, they had George C. Wolfe Day in Frankfort, Kentucky, and ended up going to the Grand Theater, which is where Black people would sit in the balcony. And then there was the Capitol Theater, which became integrated, you know, 1964, something like that. And when I went back to speak for George C. Wolfe Day, it was the first time I had gone in the front door of the Grand Theater.
Wow.
And I was going, so what power did I have as an 8-year-old boy that you were so terrified that you couldn't let me walk in the front door? And you just realize, oh, racism is vulgar and it's dumb and it's just a blanket statement that has no thought, so that those people who are imposing it don't have to examine themselves, their lives, their privilege. They can just issue a statement and then keep on walking. And so a little 8-year-old boy is a threat to the entire system. Then that must be a really fragile, dumb, fucked up system.
Right, like Ruby Bridges too. You see that picture of that little sweet girl.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable, yeah. Right.
She's exactly, destabilize all of us?
Huh?
Exactly.
She's gonna destabilize society, little Ruby Bridges?
Exactly, and these little children marching, you gotta turn dogs and hoses on them. What degree of inhumanity your racism is stripping you of your humanity.
Yeah.
Your racism is causing you to suffocate that which is based on love and possibility inside of you. It's corrupting your entire being and crippling you as a human being. And because you just make this blank impersonal statement so that you don't have to be available to the moment, so that you can protect yourself from your vulnerability. It doesn't work that way, you know. No, you don't get to do that. And people, and incredibly smart, heroic, amazing, astonishing people have been challenging it and will continue to do that. Claudette Colvin refusing to give up her seat. I'm not doing that. So.
Yeah, we're doing a program with Claudette Colvin this
month. Oh my goodness, love her, yeah. love her.
So people can tune in, be look out for that. But I just want to do one last question. I want to play another clip from the film, because what you're talking about is sentiments that are expressed through the blues.
Yeah.
And can you talk about the significance of that music? Let's take a look at this clip first.
Okay.
White folk don't understand about the blues. Their head come out, but they don't know how it got there. They don't understand that that's life's way of talking. You don't sing to feel better. You sing because that's the way of understanding life. Blues help you get out of bed in the morning. You get up knowing you ain't alone. Something else in the world. Something been added by that song. This be an empty world without the blues. Yeah. I try to take that emptiness and fill it up with something. I ain't started blues way of saying blues always been there. But if they want to call me mother blues, that's all right with me. It don't hurt none.
There's so much in that sentiment, that scene, that entire scene, but that the way music fills this heart for her and is so important to her. Can you talk about that and the theme of that in the movie?
Well, I love that scene because it's Ma at her most vulnerable, because she's speaking to that in many respects which she loves the most, which is the healing power of music. And one of the things that I think is so extraordinary, there are a bunch of things that are extraordinary about the blues. You know, Black people would write blues songs about the flood, about the Titanic, about Jack Johnson. It became the place where they could put their history and it would be safe, because it wasn't going to be found in the newspapers and it wasn't going to be found in history books. So that's one of the things that I love. And also there are, you know, there were extraordinary, you know, you have Mozart, which is about reaching for the exalted in some respects. But the thing which I think the blues does so extraordinarily well is, oh my God, it's horrible, it's terrible, I don't know. And yet, there's gonna be another day. And so it's acknowledging the moment of loss, despair, love gone, faith gone, hope gone, but then there is that sense of possibility. And I think that's what the blues gave to the world, that sense, the miracle of the human condition, regardless of where you are going through, what you are going through in the moment, looking up at the next moment and believing that it will be different. And this is extraordinary expression, you know. I'm gonna get the blues lyric wrong, but then, you know, there's this woman singing about trains, and I'm gonna get the train numbers wrong, but 219 took my baby away, 219 took my baby away, 407 gonna bring him back someday. Despair, despair, possibility. Loss, 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 maybe victory. You know, can't go on, but I will. And so that phenomenon is just, it's what an extraordinary gift to humanity. What an extraordinary gift that there is now a musical expression that articulates the wonder of human faith, the absolute extraordinary wonder of human faith. It's an astonishing gift. And it was created by people who had to keep believing on that because the structures that were created for them were about denying their humanity. So we're about denying their humanity, about denying their sense of possibility, about their denying their hope in that which is the next day, that which is tomorrow. So it's extraordinary. It's just an extraordinary gift to the planet, And you know, and Ma used to sing like showbiz tunes. She used to do all of that. And then she heard somebody singing the blues and she went, oh, that's what I needed to do. And her gifts and her voice and everything about her found a place where they belong. And then when she found that, her audience found her. And because the blues was complicated enough and deep enough and potent enough that she could put all of who she was into them and reach people. And in that first scene, we see her in that tent show, and it's a preacher and her congregation. By the time she ends up at the Grand Theater in Chicago, we're watching the interplay of the personalities who are on the stage, but we don't see the audience. They're northern. They're still recognize that sound, but they're in the process of listening to another sound, an urban sound. So that therefore, by virtue of going to Chicago, Ma is in essence witnessing her extinction. Because after that, the people who are gonna be, it's not gonna be the women singing the blues, we're gonna go through an era of Duke Ellington and his orchestra, Jimmy Lunsford and his orchestra. So there's already a disconnect, and also the people who are there who come from the South are now in the process of becoming urbanized, are becoming Chicago-esque, you know? They're listening to Jerry Roll Morton, who's up there, they're listening to Louis Armstrong, who's up there. And then you have in Harlem, you have Ellington, who's doing an even more sophisticated sound. So trying to create this, that there is this music that connects. And then there's these people, because of the circumstances, the environment that they are now working in and living in, are ready for another sound, thereby rendering Ma extinct, but never ever will they ever render the blues extinct, because it's crucial to how we survive and how we continue.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for spending time with us. This is a gift of a movie. If you haven't seen it, go watch it. So nice to spend time with you, George.
Same here. And it's like every single time, anytime I've been in Atlanta and I filmed Henrietta Lacks down there, I go, oh, the center's still there. Oh, it's because when you work on Broadway, you work on a show, and then it runs for as long as it runs. And sometimes it runs for a long time, and sometimes it doesn't. And then it's gone. So I am always sort of thrilled and overwhelmed anytime I see the center, because it's continuing. The stories continue. And so congratulations on being there and for all the work that you guys have been doing, you know, to make sure that the stories continue.
Well, thank you. And I know you've got a future movie on Bayard Rustin, and he's my, I love all the characters in the civil rights story. He is my favorite. I'm so unbelievably overjoyed that you're going to tell his life story with the Obamas and their production company. So please bring that and show, let us show it at the center. That would be an unbelievable treat.
Absolutely. Okay, great.
We'll see you then.
Okay, great. All right.
Bye.
Bye-bye.